like it was an automatic he would be the speaker that day. Let's we're going to take a little bit of break, but when we listen to Bernice King, we also, I'm hoping that you saw on your screen, those of you who are listening to us on the World Wide Web and iTunes and Ustream, thank you for listening, and please stay with us. We got a lot more conversation. I'm hoping that you were able to see Bernice King as she was planting a kiss on her father's monument. And that was, that photo to me just really told a story. She is such an embodiment of the spirit of Dr. King and what he stands for. I mean, all of the children are, I'm sure, full of the legacy of the father, but it just something about the words coming out of her mouth. And so that moment, I'm hoping you got a chance to see that photograph. We're going to take a little break. We'll come back and we'll talk a lot more about the role that black women played 50 years ago, and more importantly, the role that we play today as we move forward with our civil rights and protecting our civil liberties. So here's a break.
There used to be a grand tower alone on the sea. You became the light on the dark side of me. Love remains a drug that's high and not the pill. But did you know that when it snows, my eyes become large and the light that you shine can't be seen? A man can tell you so much he can say. You remain my power, my pleasure, my pain, baby. To me, you're like a grown addiction that I can't deny. Won't you tell me, is that healthy, baby? Did you know that when it snows, my eyes become alert and the light that you shine can't be seen? So much a man can tell you, so much he can say. You remain my power, my pleasure, my pain. To me, you're like a grown.
Okay, so we're back. Sisters at the Well Radio, a conversation with women about women. And I'm Barbara Perkins. I'm your lead host. And I'm in the studio with Glenda Gill, who is an opinion leader and activist nationwide. And I'm here with Melina Lawrence, who is a co-host at Sisters at the Well Radio. She is a producer and TV personality and journalist and activist and smart one and mentee and leader and all of that good stuff. We're just happy to have you today.
I'm happy too.
You're sandwiched between
And then
the two of us
Well, that was telepathy, because I was just saying I'm just so excited to be in the midst of two strong, powerful women in our community and on this planet. It's really a blessing, y'all, to just like be right here.
I love it.
We love having the energy. We love having you.
Thank you.
You could take over.
Yeah, she will be. So we were talking about the role that, you know, Black women played in the civil rights movement and the role, significant role that we play today as we move our communities forward. You know, we just celebrated this 50th anniversary of the March in Washington. It was an amazing week of activity. But now here we are.
Yes.
What's in front of us today? Where do we go? You know, what's critical? What should we be thinking? How do people get plugged in? Glenda, you want to start?
Well, I think some of the issues that are on the table or things that we're going to be working on is our health issues, how they're impacting our community. Human trafficking is becoming a big deal for young women that we've got to pay more attention to. Social justice. I mean, our kids are being criminalized at a very young age. And not only criminalized from the penal system, they are also being penalized about their self-esteem. Just the story just the other day about the little young girl with cornrows in her hair. Brought tears to my eyes that she was going to be sent home because her hair was unacceptable. Not good. Yeah, I mean, we're trying to grow up women.
Who would say that her cornrows are not acceptable?
Her twist, right. It was a big deal. It's a really big deal.
You know, in 1978, I was hired by American Airlines after a big lawsuit that the airlines, commercial airlines, weren't hiring a lot of African-American women, women and men for that matter. But when I was hired, I had natural hair. And we could not wear braids. You know, my hair, in fact, looked a little bit like yours, Melina.
Wasn't it like Walt Disney?
It was big. It was big, big, big hair. And, you know, I remember really thinking hard about taking the job because I did not want to change my hair, which was so much a part of who I am.
Yeah.
And one of the sheroes of that time, I don't know if you remember, Glenda, Queen Mother Moore.
Oh, I do.
Queen Mother Moore had visited our college. I was in Boston. And I was saying to her, I'm not going to take this job as a flight attendant, stewardess we were called back then, because I'm not changing my hair. I'm not going to change my hair. That's a part of who I am. And of course, she sat me down. And in her wisdom, she was very much like Dr. Hyde in terms of how patient they were. But she said, you are going to be a change agent. But you can't make many changes if you're on the outside.
Right.
You need to get inside. And if it's your hair that you're concerned about, then you get in and you work within the establishment for those women who would want their hair to be a certain way. And you work within the establishment to help that happen. And so, you know, I think here we are today talking about hair. And of course, years later, flight attendants can wear their hair braided.
Whatever. Right.
You know, so I can't even imagine today that someone would be sending a youngster home because her hair is cornrowed or twist.
It's still an issue.
Yeah. I mean, she's traumatized. She's only 5 years old.
Yeah. How dare you?
Really? How dare
you? Know,
you?
How dare you?
I mean, and then we've got to deal with the voting rights.
Yes.
You know, our rights around the, this country. And then also the whole pay issue, our employment.
Equal pay.
Right.
Yeah.
So we've got work to do. I am encouraged.
Yeah.
You know,
the immigration issue is huge for us.
Major.
We're talking about Black and brown people who have contributed to the country, continues to contribute to the country in a meaningful way, you know. And so, yeah, there's a lot of work on our plates. But what are we doing, the women?
The women are continuing to communicate, support one another. I think for us, when you see things that are not with the heart, intent, of passion, of supporting and reinforcing women, we have to address that so that we can stay on one accord to get the work done. We have so many distractions because things are coming at us left and right about how we're supposed to look, what we're supposed to do, what we're not supposed to do. But in our hearts, we know who we are and what we're to do. Mm-hmm. And if someone is tearing down someone else, I think as a woman, you just step up and say, you know, we're not going to deal with that like that. Let's right. deal with it with love, bring some love to the conversation so we can have the right types of conversations that we need to have. But what I want us to know, though, is that we are leaders, and we kind of minimize that we're leaders because it depends on what generation
that you're in. You know, Black girls, we're taught mm-hmm. our one of the cultural norms that we have to overcome is this idea that you have to be a good girl.
Yes.
You know? and there's this notion that, you know, being good means to minimize who you are.
Yeah.
And that's not so.
No, because you're not stepping into your authenticity about who God intended for you to be.
Yeah.
But I think that's a great lesson. I know for within our generation and just growing up, even myself included, we were always, I was taught even in different jobs and arenas, from lobbying to being an activist and, you know, enter quietly, then make your bang. Or, you know what I mean? Kind of like enter and walk.
I'm assuming.
Yeah. Be just lay back and listen. And listening is great. I mean, we get a lot done by listening. But when it's time to act and we got to pull out everything we have to pull out just to get the job done, the way mindsets shift for women and young women, I think sometimes we think too much, and we may think ourselves out of the momentum to getting things done because of that. The point you just made, making sure that we actually don't play small, you know, right. and don't dim our light. Like, that's something that I know for self, I always have to remind myself, because when you walk into a boardroom or a male dominant atmosphere at times, or an atmosphere where women don't play, play in a space where they're
they don't want to share.
Yeah, non-traditional. right. It's like, we don't have to. This is not a cat fight. This is a unit, and we have to move as a unit and as one. So, and that was another thing I learned at the round table, or mm-hmm. just the beauty of how the women came together to move forward, how they sacrificed. And I think that a lot of conversations during that time, during the March on Washington, the anniversary, was, what is our means of being sacrificial today, and how do we make sure that our sacrifices are going to pay off and deliver the fruits of our labor that will help the prison, you know, decrease the prison population for our young boys and our young girls, our Black women, our Black men, and increase job security and increase political power in our communities and things of that sort. So it's a new way of sacrificing, because our world is moving at Google rate, real fast speed, and Google gets you a lot of information, but I don't think Google can save our community.
And like, I think there has to be balance.
Yes,
this is what I would say to young people. There has to be balance. I mean, discipline is required no matter how fast the world moves.
Yes.
Discipline is required. And so you have to scroll down, meaning you have to be prepared. You can't just take the sound bite and run with the sound bite. So what the Dorothy Heights of the world taught us is that the Rosa Parks of the world, just in the spirit of how she remained in her seat and why she chose that day to remain in her seat. This woman had been in the struggle for many years prior to that. And the patience and the discipline, so that you're ready, so that you're ready when your moment comes. And the other thing that I try to tell young people, and even women my age, as we're moving into the leadership space, we cannot get distracted by whose name is on the marquee.
Correct.
Right.
This is one of the major hurdles when we're talking about fighting for our rights. One of the ways that we get tripped up is we begin to say, who's the leader? Well, we're all leaders. And we all have what Dr. Height has done around building the National Council of Negro Women, an organization, and she really picked up Mary McLeod Bethune's dream, the mantle, and took that leg and ran with it, her leg. We have to find our leg.
Yes.
And what Dr. Bethune said is that African American women have to have a strong presence. She said in the nation's capital, but what we're saying is in the world. because no geography can separate my heart from yours.
And you know what, Barbara?
You know, there's one mind is what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. Coming out of the consciousness of God, there is
absolutely
one mind. So no matter what part, I'm sorry, Glenda, no matter what part of the world, the universe you're in, our hearts are the same. And the perfect example of that is in 1995, I went to the Women's World Conference in China. And out of that, and I went with the Black Women's Lawyers group. Dr. Barbara Onwine is the leader of that group now in D.C. And God, it's almost 20 years now, right? One of the things we came together to do, 125 Black women, I happened to be with Dr. Height, a newbie just trying to figure it all out. But what a place to be. I was at the round table. But what I noticed was everyone put their personal agendas aside easily and said, when we leave China, we want to walk away with a document that we can all live with, that represents everyone, regardless of your religious beliefs, regardless of your language. We're talking women in the world, global document. That, can you imagine? Sometimes we get caught up in our own little cities, our own little town, our church, and we can't plan something in the church because we're distracted by some infighting thing. Whose name is going to be at the top and who's the chair and who's the leader, as opposed to really being focused on what is the job at hand? What is the mission?
One of the things, Barbara, that I loved about Dr. Height and Rosa Parks, because I had the chance to meet and be in Rosa Parks's presence. Everything
Amazing.
They did it with elegance and grace.
Everything.
They didn't have to be loud. They didn't have to overexert themselves about, I'm in the room. Mm-hmm. You just knew their mere presence that they were in the room, and you just had respect mm-hmm. for their presence and what they brought to the table. And everybody has a piece to bring. And when you have service in your heart, even though somebody else will get recognition for it, who knows that you serve? You know that you serve.
That's right.
And God knows that you served. Mm-hmm. And something was said this morning about the pastor who spoke this morning, mm-hmm. and it was about you can't hurry it up. It's mm-hmm. in your own place. Mm-hmm. It's in its own place, and it will happen in a perfect time. And if you've got to believe that and know that in order to operate as a collective. And most women are for the greater good of the community, because I liken it to bearing children, or having the ability to bear children, even if you don't biologically have children. We want to nurture. We want to love. We want it to be great for everybody. We want everybody to be happy, fed, have a roof over their house.
Right.
I mean, over their heads. And so if you come from that kind of space, you really can work as a collaborative and work good together. And for us to save our community,
yes,
we're going to have to work together. This is not the 80s and the 90s brought this whole capitalism me agenda.
Yeah. And we read it and we thought it was our story.
Right. And it's not. This is
it's
really
not
a we agenda.
Yeah.
Because if the me is going to be destroyed, because the ego always tries to outlive everything and take over mm-hmm. everything, and it never makes it. So it's a we agenda. And until we realize it's a we agenda, and everybody's going to get something out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think women know they work together as we have some things, but I think we're growing, and I think we will continue to grow. And I think as we have mature women in the circle having the discussion, they can recognize all the egos and the issues and address them
mm-hmm. yeah.
very quickly, so that they can be minimized, so we can get to the work at hand at the table. And I am so loving that we get to work with some dynamic young women like Melina.
Oh, yeah.
And, we've got April. We've got a host of young women that we're working with throughout the country, and they want to be involved. They
have to give it to them, though.
Right.
It's not enough. This is what I said at the march. It's not enough that we invite them in the room.
We have to give it to
them. We have to turn it over to them.
Yes.
And allow them to exercise their gifts.
And I'm so happy
and their talent
to them, because I'm still interested. But I'm a little tired.
And we ready
and
because we're here.
And they're capable. We're
so remember the sister, I forget her name, but she was a young sister on the second round table. To her point,
is it Tamika? She was one of the leaders.
Yeah,
Tamika Mallory.
Was long.
She was one of the. She's the leader. She is.
Yes, she is Tamika from the National.
Uh-huh. You should know. She is not just.
She represents
this young sister is representing Reverend Al Sharpton's organization, national organization.
And she spoke at the opening on the mall of the 50th anniversary.
Tamika. Absolutely. That was her name.
And she didn't just start. Mm-hmm. So this is the perfect example of growing up in the movement and being patient and scrolling down.
Yes. And somebody recognized
and
your
being
talent.
Prepared. Yes.
I think that you know, what she said, I wanted to hear her speak more because when she spoke, she said what she had to say and it was done. She's just like, we're here. We're not going anywhere. We don't need elders. We don't even need y'all to hand us anything. We're ready. We're willing. Mm-hmm. And then the elder that was head of the A. Philip Randolph Foundation, she spoke up and said, you know what, baby? Let's just get out of their way. Let's get out of the young people's way and let them have it.
Yeah.
And there was countless reasons as to why that we talked about it, but I think it just solidified the energy in the room and the vibes that surrounded. I mean, all over the planet, is that young people are taking steps to be in control, whether they have guidance or guidance is on the way to them. They're in a place to where, they may not be able and we may not be able to always articulate it, but the action present and the intent behind change
now showing up is the first step.
Exactly.
But yes. you show up, but you also must be prepared. There's no substitute for preparation. Mm-hmm.
And you
have
to
be ready
to serve.
Yes.
And so we want the confidence and the courage and you to show up. We want that for young people. We don't want you to just step up and say this was said in church this morning too. Oh, I'm here. So reward me. Give me the big chair because I showed up.
give
me the big chair.
Right.
We want you to show up. But we want you to be prepared and we want that representation because we don't get a lot of second chances at doing this. So what was different between two generations ago and now is that the mentoring was consistent and it was seamless. And so you brought someone along and you knew, you watched the movie, The Butler.
The Butler.
Exactly.
You know, and you knew you had to wait. And, you know, you wait your turn and you were being patient.
And you were learning along the way.
And they were being trained.
Because you were getting all the knowledge, everything that you needed to be prepared, to be prepared for that role.
Yes.
Remember when he took the role and the gentleman asked him, his mentor asked him something about, do you know how to do such and such? And he started reciting everything. He knew more than the mentor knew because he was in class. Mm-hmm. No one saw him getting that lesson. You didn't see where he was studying, when he was reading. So we're telling young people, we want you to step up to the plate. We want you to have this turn. But we also want you to be ready. We want you to study. We want you to read. We want to meet you where you are. Mm-hmm. And then we want to help you.
Because really our role, I work with a lot of people in the automotive industry, and a lot of people are aging out. They're retiring. They're leaving. And I was describing to someone, I said, I need to know all the young people. And they said, why? I said, because they need to know the history.
Yeah.
Because when you sit at the table and you start sharing with them things that happened before that will have some impact on what they're doing and moving forward.
Yeah.
So they need to know so they don't step into those minefields.
That's right.
And I said, as we age out, and when I say age out, I'm just saying aging out of a work industry.
Yeah,
that's
I'm
all.
Aging out, but I'm going to the beach.
Right.
I'm real clear.
I'm on the journey.
I'm not checking out. This is an intention.
The advisory board. board.
I say
we have a golden advisory board.
Call me, Melina. Let me know what you're doing.
I said I work hard. I work hard, but I play harder. I'm getting more to the play harder role.
Yeah.
But I want to know the young people. I want them to have the knowledge they need to succeed. And as you said, they don't get a second chance. Mm-mm. And so I want to know who they are because, you know, I need to make a call and say, hey,
Right.
We need this. Right. You know about this? And then we also need you engaged over here.
Yeah, and young people have to this? Be willing to accept it. Right. You know, I mean, I have, okay, they'll probably not like this, but I have a daughter who's 26 and a son 23. And I remember my daughter saying, I don't want you to help me. I don't want you to call anybody for me. Really? Why do you think I'm doing all of this? Yeah. If I can't help you at home.
What's the point?
You mean you really want to struggle?
My son the same way. And I said to him, I can do what I need to do. But I might have to call in a favor for you. Yeah. So he told me, I don't need your help. I said, okay.
It may be a little cultural too sometimes.
No, he ended up saying one day, Mom,
call.
I need your help.
Make that call. Yeah, make that call.
So I'm saying that's what we're here for. We've done all of this. We know we can go get what we need, but we save up the favors for the next generation.
Right.
And so when we have to pull on that favor, it's for you, because I can get what I need to get for me.
But y'all know that, too. You're like, y'all just lay back and watch, and you're like, okay, you ready now? Okay, look, this is what you got to get, and I'm going to make that call. And we're like, okay, humble.
We just want you to be receptive. So speaking of call, you know, we may have a caller, so I want to give out the number if you want to call. It's 323, area code, 247-7443. Again, the call-in number is 323. 247-7443. And this is Sisters at the Well Radio, a conversation with women about women. We're going to take a little short break, but if you'd like to call or Facebook us, please do so. And we'll be right back in about 2 minutes.
Is her hair, thanks to himself, such a lovely face, gives his entire self, shares his secrets, but it's all in vain, his love for her drowns him in a sea of denial, the fear of being alone, will it keep her there? That sincerity, while she may only pretend, he loves with sweetness and sincerity, while she may only
So we're back, Sisters at the Well, a conversation with women about women. And we left before we went on the break. We were talking about, you know, just transitioning to the young generation, the new generation, and really supporting them in taking over the leadership, because, you know, it's your world. We want to make sure that we leave it in a way that you could pick it up and take the next leg and do it. I'm proud of you. I'm also going to give a shout out to Miss Sabrina, who's in the studio. You can't see her, but Sabrina Johnson, who is the associate producer for this show and who does a really good job pulling it all together, and an amazing dancer. And we love her, too. And so we want to give her a shout out, and all the other young sisters across, you know, the nation that are doing this work. We are just really pleased to have you. I think we might have a caller, so why don't we do that, and then we'll come back and finish our conversation. Okay. Hello, caller.
Hi, how are you? This is Diane calling.
Hi, Diane. This is Barbara. How are you?
I'm great. I would just want to say you're having such a wonderful show.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Anything you want to add to the conversation?
No, I think it's just so interesting, the dynamics between all the guests. It's just a wonderful show to watch, and I definitely would tell all my friends about it.
Well, thank you. This is Sisters at the Well Radio right here at LA Talk Live. We're happy that you called in. If you'd like to call, the number again is 323-247-7443. And today we're talking about the role that black women play in our leadership, in our civil rights, and in the current issues, you know, that's facing us today. And Glenda, let's start, you know, let's pick it up and talk about what you think, what's a priority issue for you? Where are you specifically? Because I know there's so many things to work on, but is there one particular thing that you're most interested in?
Our role at the table.
When you say the table, what do you mean?
Well, I say from an economic perspective, I work, I primarily in the role that I serve in, I work with Rainbow Push Coalition, and I advocate from a diversity perspective on roles of women and people of color in corporate America in different areas. As you know, for me, it's automotive is my focus.
Yeah.
And so I would say equality and justice is probably the strongest points for me. I think that we have freedom, but I don't think that we're equal. And I don't think that we're equal in the veins of economic justice. I don't think we're equal in the veins of legal justice.
Yeah.
I think those things have still to overcome. And I think when we get to the table, we are somewhat minimized about our ability, and our ability is great. And so that is why we always want to show up twice as good, doing even more. And for me, that is what I spend my life being passionate about. I deserve a seat at the table. I don't take any backseat about it. This morning I went to the farmer's market and I was a little strong with this guy. And I said, I don't see you showing up. And, you know, I said to him, hi, how are you? And he said, good. I said, I don't see you showing up. Oh, I have to get back to you on that. I said, I know you're not showing up, and that's going to be a mistake.
Ooh. Ooh.
And then I had to, on my way to the car, I said, you weren't your feminine self this morning. You know, but I've done this for a long time, and I think you get more comfortable. And I don't want to say I get more jaded, but I get more comfortable about being able to speak my mind about what's showing up and what's not showing up. And I don't think that we should allow people to discount us. We have as much right to be here as anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the ability to lead, even with the person that I work with. You know, I've taken a leadership role. I used to be very much in the background, and I think I was a little intimidated and uncomfortable. However, what...
Meaning Reverend Jackson. Okay.
However, I have learned so much from him. He's not a perfect man, but he has a perfect vision for us.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, and he's, you know, the women in the organization are the leaders of that organization. He is the iconic figure. However, the women in the organization, they step it up and they do everything. And so I've been so blessed to be able to be in that presence, because that was not what I had in mind for me at all.
Yeah.
You know, only God had that in store for me. I never saw myself there. And it has been a tremendous role, but one I feel very passionate about. I feel so passionate about civil rights and women's rights. I laugh because at the March on Washington, there were a bunch of men, and they had panels, and they had big signs, and they had microphones, and they were talking about women's reproductive rights.
Okay.
And we were walking, and I said, there's not one woman standing over there talking about her body. It's five men. Can any of them have children? No.
Yeah.
So, you know, women have got to be in all the conversations that really engage them. And they really have to take a leadership role in that.
Yeah. And I think we have to teach. But I do believe we started out saying we have to teach from a place of knowing, but also a place of love.
Of course.
Because we have to teach so that people can hear you. And sometimes, including myself, it's a communication style. I know I have a style of I'm strong, I'm confident, And at times, if I feel like I'm not being heard, I will push really hard, mm-hmm. and you will feel it.
Yes, Barbara. Yes. Just
Are
say
you
yes.
Speaking truth to power.
and we need to know how to do that, but we also need to know how to really temper our energy. Mm-hmm. And as Ayanla Van Zant would say, watch your tongue.
Correct.
Yeah.
You know, watch your tongue and make sure that there's love in there, so that even if my words are hard or appear harsh, there's never a mistake about whether or not I care about you.
Because that's not your intent.
And I love you. Right. And intent will always come through.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, even if it takes a moment, it will always come through.
But Barbara, that's why I say we have to communicate, because I find especially in this era of technology, with social media and Twitter and texting, sometimes you can see something and you know it's just didn't come through right. And mm-hmm. I've had that happen a lot of times, where I started writing a message and said, no, let me pick up the phone because the message, the way that I'm writing this, even though that's not my intent, mm-hmm. it might be interpreted another way. And if I already know that, I just mm-hmm. said, let me pick up the phone. And you will not, you can imagine how many things happen through emails and texts and all
absolutely.
Of that,
yes.
that, you know, people get offended by, yeah. and it's not the intention. And so that's something that we've got to manage in this generational piece as well.
Tone.
That
right.
women, we've got to communicate in a way that we know, I want to touch you, I want to love on you. Mm-hmm. Texting and email doesn't
yeah, you have
me
to
that.
Make time for that personal right. face-to-face, as much as organizing a component of being a good organizer now is social media. It really takes that old school, like, grassroots rules, and will always be, like, word of mouth is still the number one thing for sales. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to always be mindful. And I tell myself this, I remind myself of that. And I just, you know, I think we're all personally conflicted at times to pick up the phone versus send a text message or send an email, because your tone can be so misconstrued, you know.
Correct.
You can just,
yeah,
and you just have to say hi, just hello, are you there, you know, call
right.
me.
Yeah, but you have to have that connection mm-hmm, with people.
Definitely.
So listen, let's talk a little bit about, because we're wrapping up, we have about 3 minutes mm-hmm. or so, but I want to what's coming up next for us is the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation has every year an annual legislative conference, and people from around the country come into Washington, D.C., again, the seat of power, mm-hmm. to really learn and share what's going on in their community. But most importantly, touch the Congressional Caucus leaders and find out what they're doing. One of the issues that is front and center, we know, among the other things we talked about today, immigration and social justice and our civil rights, is this piece on human trafficking.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. As we talk about Black women, and in particular, International Black Women's Public Policy Institute, which is an organization that I co-founded with a woman named Ka Fluellen out of Washington, D.C. It's a 5-year-old organization. Once a year, we host a hearing around a particular issue. For the last 2 years, we have been really trying to raise the awareness about the disproportionate number of Black women and girls that are trafficked right here in this country.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
This isn't an issue that's so far away that we don't have to be concerned about it. This is
in every community
on the corner.
Yes. Every community.
Every community across this nation. And so one of the things we're doing, and Congresswoman Karen Bass has been a champion, so has retired member Congresswoman Diane Watson, who actually helped to shepherd our organization. Glenda was one of the founding members of the organization. But we're hosting this hearing where we are building what we're calling the largest women's collaborative. And this coalition of women, it's a temporary organization. We're not trying to build anything new. We're not trying to pull people off mm-hmm. their own message. We just want to say, for this time, can we all come together and really raise the awareness around the dangers and the risk that our young girls and boys are in across the country around trafficking. So that's coming up. The Congressional Black Caucus starts Wednesday, September 18th. Mm-hmm. And it's 4 days of lots of activity around this. The Black Women's Roundtable, I know we'll be doing a lot around health. The issue of childhood obesity is being talked about quite a bit. And so, Melina, are you going to the caucus?
Yes, I do plan on going to caucus and participating in the roundtables, participating fully just in the caucus this year. And any issues that are surrounding Black women and incarceration of our young Black males is one of, you know, my top issues and passion priorities as well. And the Voting Rights Act, making sure that we don't lose our civil liberties, our civil rights is something that I have my eyes on and participating as well. Congresswoman Barbara Lee is also having a constituents breakfast.
Oh, yeah.
And I'll be attending that. And just a host of it, we'll be roaming, you know, our crew will be roaming. So all of my sisters that I'm surrounded by, magnificent women and sisters such as yourself and my other comrades, we're coming to DC this year with a different vibe and fever.
Okay, so let's close it out. Glenda, closing comments from you
as women,
and
as a leader.
Yeah,
I would say that we must keep on being strong. We must keep on supporting each other. We must love each other. And when you see a sister that's down, you got to pick her up, give her a kiss, give her a hug, and give her some love and help her on her way.
Yeah.
You know, we have got to, we are our sister's keepers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Melina?
Yeah, sisters at the well, thank you. And all the sisters out there of all ages, I just think it's important that in closing remarks that you do pick a priority, you have a passion priority, and you own it, and you open yourself up to receive the assistance you need and carry out our vision and your vision for the community, I as we, and to thyself be true.
Yeah. Well, I just want to say thank you, ladies. This has been the fastest hour. Sisters at the Well Radio is about really facilitating the dialogue that we are most interested in. How do we do better? We know that when we know better, we do better. We know that we stand on the shoulders of some very strong women who gave a lot for us. And we're not going to let them down. No, not on our watch. We're going to take care of our babies. We're going to meet them where they are. We're going to do the work in our communities. We're going to roll up our sleeves. We're not tired. No way are we tired. I say thank you for listening. See you next Sunday right here at LA Talk Live. Sisters at the Well Radio, a conversation with women about women. Peace.
Thank you.
Peace.
Never knew there was a place to go where my spirit's thirst is quenched. Hold on to yourself, I'm hearing. Hold on to the best of who you are. It wasn't quite the way I had imagined, yet it's more than all my dreams. To go where my spirit's thirst is quenched. Hold on to yourself, I'm hearing. Hold on to the best, who you are. It wasn't quite the way I had imagined, yet it's more than all my dreams. Hold on to yourself, I'm hearing. It's more than what it seems. For here they are gathered, here they are just like you. And right here it all matters.
As a Christian, I have found that the Lord Jesus Christ is healer. He has paid a price through the shedding of his blood to not only cover our sins, to save us and to deliver us, but also to heal us. And this song speaks about him being the healer. Let him.
Hey, hey, everybody, what's going down? This is your main man, BT, and this is another installment for GospelRhythms.com, Heaven's Party here on Earth. If you haven't been to the site yet, I strongly advise you to go check them out. They got some great stuff going on over there for those gospel lovers or music that is inspirational and that people are feeling. So with that said, I definitely want to jump into it, but I got to give my shout outs to the East Coast, to the West Coast, everybody in between who's pumping Oso Lounge. So this is kind of a collaboration of Gospel Rhythms and Oso Lounge together. So shout outs to Ro, who's keeping it down and holding it down over there at Gospel Rhythms. Like I said, check out their site and also check out our site, you know, osolounge.com. And with that said, let's just jump right into the music. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. Thank you.
calling to commitment, but no one's picking up on then alone can you get everything that I need, yeah. You brought the light and you brought the truth. Now I feel redeemed. I just want more of you tomorrow than I had of you today. I hope that's alright with you now. Would you stick around? Cause I got to keep you close
enough to hear.
Yes, I do.
What did you say?
Get you closer,
closer to me.
Got to get you
close enough to be everything you ask.
I got to get you closer,
closer than a second from now.
Make it last,
make it last.
I feel alone in a crowded room, searching for a friend now. But I remember the afternoon that this love affair began.
When I gave you my heart, you took it. Gave you my pain and you wrote back the tears.
Can I take the time to thank you, Lord, just for being here? I can't let the fire go out. I can't let the music stop now. Gotta shape my day around my love for you. Cause I got to get you close. I got to get you closer.
Closer than
oh,
closer to me.
Can I get you close?
Close enough.
Yeah.
To anything you ask.
Can I get you closer?
Closer than a second from now.
Ooh.
To make it last. For as long as it takes to make you happy with me. No price is too great. All that means.
And there is nothing I need more than your presence with me. Cause I know you love me, and I could not live if you go. So I got to get you close.
Close enough to hear every word you say.
Can I get you close?
Closer than a moment.
Closer.
Now, this is definitely another love song, and I'm gonna keep speaking about this, just keep speaking it, because love is what love is.
Hello.
I'm gonna keep talking about the substance of the things I hope for. I'm looking forward to the future, y'all. I thought I loved rhyming, but you got me trying to find a diamond when it shine. It remind me of you, so whenever you happen to gaze in it, envision me and you a team and we holding the world pennant like a true champion in a championess. Linked to marinate for a moment in God's best. Cause if he sees we're moving in the same direction, then our heart grows fonder with the love and affection we can maintain to the next plane. Shoot, be still in love like a photo in a picture frame. Compliment each other where the other may lack. It's like a match. We going good together like the gap. It's like vivid love, just to learn it isn't art. People claim to fall in love, soon later they fall apart. But let's decide to stand if the battle increases. Stick together and build like Lego pieces. It goes.
Hello, future, glad to meet you. Had to wait some time to see you. Wanted to learn how to treat you right. Now you look so bright. Say hello to the future. Had to wait some time. Wanted to learn how to treat you right. Now you
think
look
it's
so
real.
Right.
Look, hey. You're the special lady that's been crossing my mind. Definite treasure by the book, like all the magical find. You a gem in the physical, rich in the spirit, like the blend of a fresh beat mixed the perfect lyric. Instead of loud and bobbing, you was cool and collected, dressed with every ounce of class to be respected. I took advice. advice like my mom say. Don't go falling all crazily in love like Beyonce. Or you can wind up in a wreck like Kanye. Victim of severe heartburn like Pompeii. I'm learning lessons through these trials and errors. Told God I'm down to wait, soon the future appeared. Yes, and doing it his way would minimize the hassle. No sorry Mario, but she's in a different castle. Yo, where she from, says my questioning crew. They wanna know where they can go to get a girl like you. And we sing,
hello, future, glad to meet you. Had to wait some time to see you. Wanted to learn how to treat you right. Now you look so bright. Hello to the future. Had to wait some time. Wanted to learn how to treat you right.
And the
now
way I see it is
so
like
bright.
This. It costs to build. Love don't come cheaply. Pretty stays the skin, but yours goes deeply. Beauty and wisdom in your figure uniquely. Hear your heart like a harp when melodically speaking. It costs to build. Love don't come cheaply. Pretty stays the skin, but yours goes deeply. Beauty and wisdom in your figure uniquely. Hear your heart like a harp when melodically speaking.
Hello, future, glad to meet you.
Ooh, yeah.
Had to wait some time.
Jay, if you don't mind.
You
know, take these people out of guide into it to the future.
To the future,
yeah.
Hey, this is Trisha Mann Grant
and Tony Grant,
and you're listening to Gospel Rhythms Talk Live Radio on
LATalkLive.com.
What's up, everybody? I'm Zacardi Cortez, and this is GospelRhythms.com, Heather's Party on Earth.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
I was just about to lift my seat up. How y'all doing? Happy Sunday. I'm still going to do it. Can we just lift
We're just getting
up?
Situated. Welcome, welcome. This is GospelRhythms.com, Talk Live Radio on LATalkLive.com, and I am Roe Williams.
Hey, hey, I am Trisha Mann Grant, and it is a pleasure to be with you guys today. Even though I can't see you, I'm feeling the love. I'm sending you love back.
This is our music edition. Woo! We got a great show today, as all of our shows are great, actually, but this is a really great show. We have a great guest in-house, so please, before we get rolling out, please text, tweet,
Facebook,
Instagram, you know,
yes,
all your peeps,
all that stuff,
telephone, if you use your celly, yeah. Or your landline, or however you got to get it out there.
However.
Man, you know, y'all have to forgive me. I got the sniffles a little bit, but we're going to fly. You know, it's allergy season. I don't know what it is. I've had to take two Allegra, and I'm still dripping.
Girl, do an Allegra commercial.
I'm about to fire them.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. They're not quite efficient. You know, this is not a good plug for them, but I praise the Lord I'm here. And, girl, you're looking good as always.
Oh, you're so sweet.
Yeah,
I appreciate that.
Yeah,
and even
supermodel.
Even though you're not feeling that great, you're just still beautiful, sister. Just come from inside and out.
Thank you.
We actually send each other checks in the mail during
it's
the week.
It's so funny because she keeps looking at me. Are you all right? What's wrong? Yeah, What's wrong?
I'm wrong. As soon as I walk through the door.
I'm kind of snarling because I'm trying to hold back the drip. You know, when you have to make that face, you're like.
No, let's not get no more detail.
TMI, sis. Well, speaking of TMI, you know, you can't ever get too much TMI with the Word Edition. And that's what went down last week.
Yay.
Pastor Don Turner Carter was here dropping a word, and it was inspired by her subject for the show was inspired by the butler. And, you know, she had, you know, the first Sunday before for July, she had young fly, saved and sanctified and single. Yeah. And she had a group of young people in, but this was a seasoned, saved and sanctified and sexy saints who were in the house. And it was great to have such wonderful saints that came in and mm-hmm. and they were just sharing about what their experiences were back when, you know, the civil rights movements were at its peak. Mm. You know, I mean, it was just, and then we had a lot of images. We even had a image that she brought in of Emmett Till and Trayvon and wow. the message that it sent, you know, back then and today. We still are going through some things, you know, and the, you know, even though, you know, a lot of the dream we've been able to realize, there's still, when it comes to just equality and love across the board, we still have a long way to go. And it was interesting to see some of the images of the whites only, you know, and Pastor Dawn was sharing how her son, he was familiar with discrimination but had not had a real understanding of segregation. Mm. You know, and that was interesting. And so we had some images of, you know, some of the young folks that sat, did that participated in the sit-in at Woolworth, that was it, well, not Woolworth, maybe it was Woolworth counter, and as well as the picture of the butler and then the staffing at the White House. So it was really an inspirational show.
And you saw the butler. I didn't see it yet.
It was amazing.
You it loved it. My mother amazing. Saw it. She calls me like every other day. She's like, have you seen the movie yet? No, Mom, I'm going. I'm going. You have to see it. If I say it's good, it's good. Of course.
Yeah, man. And, you know, and the week before that, you know, we had the Williams edition followed by the Grant edition. You have to tell our folks how that was. Who was on that show?
Orin Williams and his brother Zach Williams and their mom, Sabina Cabay. And Orin and Zach, they attend the Covenant Church, which is my church, 4830 South Genesta. Pastor Sanchez, woo-woo, hey, Pastor. Hey. We had an anointing service today, by the way. It was
I heard. The word got out before we even got here.
My God, it was just ridiculous. Like, the Holy Spirit was like, hello, 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 and was all over the place, and, you know, we couldn't contain ourselves. But, Orin and Zach are just two amazing young men in their, I think Orin is 20, mm-hmm. 21, and Zach is 19. Anyway, young. I love to see young men who really have a heart for God, and they're just great kids, and they're just so cool. Like, really, if they could be my sons, in addition to the son I already have, I still love him too, but I would take them in as my kids because they're that great and talented. They're in the business.
And not only that, but they're grounded. You know, these are young men who are fine. They are handsome young men in the world, working in the industry, and they are working actors.
Yeah.
You know, they have a resume already.
Commercials.
Like,
films.
For real.
I mean,
and,
TV.
It was just amazing. Yeah. And then you had a Man Talk moment. How was that? Because your son made a cameo.
Yeah,
what was that about?
You know, I love my son because he'll always
we got a picture of him. Y'all kicking it.
You know, he'll start off saying, nah, I don't want to talk, but then he got on there and always makes mama proud. But I just asked them about the young ladies in the business and what advice would they give the young ladies in the business. And of course, I think Zach was saying, hey, be careful what you wear.
Oh,
you know, you don't
know.
Just certain
really
things you don't
impressed
need
with some
to
of the
wear.
Things that they were you know what he said, I'm having a hard enough time. I don't need you to help me to cross
that's
the
what
line.
My son said. He said, look,
I knew somebody said
I don't
that.
Need any more temptation. Y'all just be careful what you wear. We don't need to see all that. And I think that young ladies, the insecurities with a lot of young ladies is they feel that they have to put on the Daisy Dukes and have everything showing
and tweak
get
it.
That extra attention when they don't use their own mentality, their intelligence, the beauty that comes from within them, the words that come from them. They don't have to just put it out there in the faces of guys, because actually what that does is give the men a whole nother mindset toward them and not the right mindset. You know, so
and
don't
you
be
know
offended.
What I know this is not even a Man Talk moment, but I appreciate that they were young and they had, you know, that standard, because, you know, in reflecting back, this occurred after, you know, that show, but the whole incident with Miley Cyrus and here they're artists. These are artists in the entertainment industry, although they're actors. I feel that there is a level of responsibility that, I mean, yeah, you can cross it so people can talk about you, but you have to just a moral obligation, I think, mm-hmm. that when God has allowed you to ascend to a certain you know, level of success that of course, you know, you can do it and you can get all the attention, but you know, sometimes we need to take a little more time in deliberating what might be the impact and the consequences. You know what I'm saying?
What kind of attention do you want? Do you want the right attention or the wrong attention?
But how about this? How about the kind of attention that influences this young girl who was looking up to you to think that you, because you've endorsed it, That makes it okay. Right. We just had them talking about how it's not cool. Then Miley Cyrus goes on an award show and makes it cool again.
Well, no. And she even technically, no, not technically. According to my 12-year-old daughter who used to watch Hannah Montana. I used to I'd mess that child's name up all. I'd be like, Hannah Montana. She's Hannah Montana, mama. So anyway, she would watch that show time. And DaBaby. We have a beautiful 5-year-old here with our guest. It's his daughter, and she's a cutie pie. She just dropped something under the table. She's doing the most over here, but we love it. She's so cute. But anyway. Yeah.
She's so cute. I'm like, wait.
My baby is not feeling Miley Cyrus right now at all. She's not feeling it. But you know what? Real quick, since you mentioned the man talk, and because we have something coming out in our magazine, in the Gospel GR magazine, dealing with man talk, for all the guys out there, if you want to be heard in the magazine, I'm doing a thing. Where I'm asking this question, if there's something that you could tell a woman, one thing, what would that be? If there was something you really want her to know, really important, what would that be? And all you got to do is hit me up on mantalk.com, mantalk.com, or go to Facebook, you know, Man Talk with Trisha Mann Grant, and just click onto the page and do me a favor and answer that for me. What is the one thing that you would share advice with a woman? Whether it be a relationship, whether it be your sister, whether it be a friend, that you want women to know, coming from a man's point of view, I need to know. So all you guys all across the world, hit me up, and I will choose the top 20 answers, and we will print them in the GR magazine.
And we won't say what issue, because we got to make sure we get.
We won't say what issue, but it's going to be printed in one of the very soon upcoming issues. Definitely posted on Facebook as well.
Well, no, it's an online. Issues. So yeah. It'll be online.
Okay.
So,
that's cool.
I don't want to mislead anybody.
All right.
Unintentionally.
Well, you misled me. I thought it was going to be printed in the magazine.
It is going to be printed online.
Okay. It's going to be printed online. All right. Well, that's cool.
No, I didn't. It was a miscommunication.
That's a good thing. That's something we should talk about soon, too. Miscommunication. Because it causes so many problems. Even, you know, male, female relationships, friendships, even just your family, if you don't communicate properly, it can set up destruction, people. So let's make sure we communicate. As I talk to you, I talk to me while I'm saying that, all right? So how y'all doing? How's everybody out there doing?
Everybody is good. I wanted to, before we go into talking about our next guest, I want to give a chance to remind people about your poet. The poet Trish. Who is that chick?
Oh, that chick is me. Introducing the poet Trish is on cdbaby.com. And so far, it's been affecting a lot of people. I had a friend. I don't know. Did I tell you guys a story last Sunday? Because sometimes I'll forget. But I had a friend hit me up and he said, I played it. I played Don't Beat the Love Out of Me in front of my family and friends at the barbecue. He said, Trisha, I'm sorry, but it did cause some fights. He said a couple fought.
Wow.
And he said two girls got up and walked out and couldn't hear the rest of it. It was too much for them. Because it's very raw.
It's heavy.
It's very graphic. It's heavy, but it's real.
You know, and just if anybody would ask to play the advocate, like, well, then why? What make us want to listen to it?
What will make you want to listen to it is for all those people that you know that have been in any verbally or physical abusive relationships. People that are in relationships that are just not good for them. This is just in your face. Type of song. It's got acting in it, singing, and poetry and music. So I'm trying to bring the theatric to the poetry, but it's a true story, and it's based on a situation that happened with my girlfriend, and her daughter saw it, and I told you guys about that last time, how the daughter walked into the room and heard her.
Yeah, I've heard it, and it's definitely artistically intense, but you know, for those of you who are in ministry, whether it's it doesn't necessarily have to be faith-based, because you could be dealing with the battered situations in a home as a counselor, or it'd be a great tool that you can use in your ministry or in your workplace that can really bring home and paint in such a artistic way the impact that you know, abuse, verbal and physical abuse can have, mm-hmm. not just on the lives of the people that are the, because men get abused too,
yes,
that are the object mm-hmm. of the abuse, but the children that are affected.
That's right.
As you shared the story about how, I think, with your friend's daughter, you know.
She walked in. Yeah. Or right, and saw what the dad beating the mom with the weight.
Yeah.
So, you know, as heavy as it is, actually, my friend said it sparked a huge debate about Rihanna and Chris Brown. And everybody, you know, then the girls were saying, well, I know you're not never going to do that to me. And the guys were like, well,
there must have been a barbecue. I guess all kind of miscommunication was going down in that barbecue.
It was, according to him, he said, Trish, it really went on for a long time. He said,
you set it off.
And some people realized that they were with the wrong person because they realized that person adhered or actually
sided,
was cool with being abusive and thought there's nothing wrong with hitting a woman depending on what she does.
You mean they did a Chris Rock, you know,
Chris Brown.
Everybody
Chris
gets
Brown.
No, Chris Rock. He's the one who said, there's a reason. He just said you just don't kill him. He said you can find a reason to shake him real good, you know.
Wow. Either way it goes. If you're not putting your hands on me in love, don't touch me.
I heard that.
And the same goes for me. There's no need for a woman to put her hands on a female. And women don't think it's okay to touch a man just because you're a female. No, it's not okay. Like I tell my son, if you ever get in a relationship and she's putting her hands on you, walk away, baby, and don't look back. Keep it moving, because that will get you in jail for something she is, you know, doing. And no, I tell him, you don't touch a woman either. Okay. So, you know, I believe on both sides of the thing. It's a fair thing. Don't touch anybody.
Well, on the lighter side of love, because this is the music edition. Oh, man. Like I said, we have a great show today. We have the incomparable J. Deal in the house. Woo. Baltimore, East Coast born. Woohoo!
Yeah.
Yes. Woohoo! Man, he is an American composer, arranger, music producer, and orchestra in a variety and various genres, including pop, gospel, and hip hop. Man, he's worked with some of the greatest of the great. Everyone from Janet Jackson, Lady Gaga, Snoop Dogg, Diddy, Mary, Karen Clark Sheard, Neo, Faith Evans, Todd Tribbett, T-Pain, Jessica Simpson, Wynton Marcellus, Elton John, Jill Scott, Diane Warren.
We got your
Kirk
bio.
Kirk Franklin. And his latest artists, Brent Jones, which he's here to talk about that product today, as well as some of the great things that he has going on. You probably saw him as he tiptoed behind us to deal with his little princess, who she's
so
such a treasure.
Beautiful.
And her name means treasure. And we'll get to meet her a little bit too, because behind every great man is a great woman or little woman helping them keep it all together. Amen.
Amen. That's right.
On that note, we're going to go to commercial, and we come right. And, you know, I guess, you know, make sure you tweet and Facebook and Instagram and tell all your folks to tune in to our music edition. We'll be right back with more gospelrhythms.com. Talk Live Radio in LA, talklive.com.
Hey everyone, this is Richard Carr, Business Relations Manager for LA Talk Live. Did you know social media produces almost double the marketing leads of trade shows, telemarketing, direct mail, or even pay-per-click ads? And that about 46% of all online users count on social media when making that ever-important purchase decision. Hey, if you feel lost when it comes to social media, Top Tier Media can help you. Top Tier Media specializes in social media management and blogger outreach for beauty, fashion, health, and lifestyle brands. To learn more, go to www.toptiermedia.com. That's www.toptiermedia.com. Top Tier Media, the official social media marketing company of LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network.
Hey, shout us out. What's the count? I'm your host, Ferran Dozier. I'm inviting you to join me on WDC Radio every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time as we discuss community topics around health, sports, and entertainment. So don't forget to shout us out. What's the count? On WDC Radio, only on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. What's the count?
Hi, this is Elena inviting you to join me every Wednesday at noon for Elena's Beauty Talk and more, exclusively on LA Talk Live. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hey, welcome back to GospelRhythms.com on LATalkLiveRadio.com. Hey, thank you so much for being with us. I am Trisha Mann Grant.
And I am Ro Williams with the sniffles.
That's all right, girl. You are going to be okay. Thank you.
I know
thank
you're
you so much,
be okay
Veneric.
Your coffee has arrived.
Veneric is the man. Thank you for the coffee. Mm-hmm. And we have Jay Deal in the house, y'all.
Yay!
Hey, Jay, with super the beautiful
Super producer.
Beautiful baby girl. I can't wait for us to see
her. Hey, you
her.
Got degrees.
Wow.
You got brains, like mathematics. I'm like, really?
I do. I have one degree right now. I'm working on another one as we speak. Another couple right now. But the one that I earned so far is a pure mathematics degree.
Wow. With all your success, I have to ask, what makes you keep on wanting to learn? And what are those degrees in? Because some people are like I got to a point once where I was like, you know what? I'm done. It's okay. I'm learning through the school of hard knocks. I don't need to go back.
I hear you.
But then you do.
Yeah, you know, my dad is a huge influence on me, and wow, he went through several different disciplines in education and achieved high levels in all of them, so it just inspired me, and I've seen what he was able to do with that. He's able to help a lot of people.
Wow.
And now that I'm older now, like I'll be 40 next year, so my focus is more so on what is my legacy gonna, what am I leaving?
Wow.
So I want to teach at higher levels and mentor at higher levels.
Sure.
I started writing a book since I was a kid. I've been saving my journals since I was a kid. Nice. And everywhere I've been in the world, I've made entries in this journal. So I think just to validate a lot of my ideas and other methodologies that I have, it would be great to have some degrees under my belt. So people say, well,
what are you studying?
I want to earn it first before I broadcast it.
Okay, no
but
worries.
One of them, I eventually will get a JD. So I'm not going to be a lawyer, but I'm going to practice law in unconventional ways.
Okay.
Yeah,
good.
So
nowadays, that's a good thing to know law, whether you are a lawyer or not.
Yeah, my dad.
Especially
did
being
it.
A black man.
Yeah, my dad. He doesn't even practice law. He just uses that knowledge to help people.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow. It's good awesome. To hear you as a brother talk highly of your dad, that he was in your life.
Yeah.
Because so many stories, you know, successful brothers, you know, especially Miss Mantalk, you can attest to this probably mm-hmm. more than anybody with all the men that you probably have spoken with on it, that they're broken men, but they had to learn to be a success in spite of the brokenness of the home life that they may have been raised. So mm-hmm. share what yeah. that have been. Were you raised in a two-parent home or...
Yeah, you know, it's hilarious. I just, my church had a Price is Right competition over the summer, and they have this family gathering, and Tony Evans came and spoke, and I won the grand prize for the Price is Right.
Wow.
Which included a cruise to a lot of destinations. You could choose Hawaii, Alaska, whatever. So I gave it to my parents.
Was this Faithful Central, right?
This is Faithful Central.
I heard about that. I was like, you
won.
I won.
What?
We made it. I was like, hey.
Where was I? I did not. I used to go to Faithful Central.
Girl, they didn't give out gifts like that when we were coming up.
They didn't, right? Bishop on my mouth. That was at
Faithful Central.
Yeah.
I heard about that.
Be there next year.
Oh, my goodness. Right,
you said be there next
year. Yeah. So I won, and I gave my parents the cruise for their 40th wedding anniversary.
Wow.
So they've been together for 40 years. I'm 39, so it's just like.
Now, are you an only child?
I have a sister that's a year younger than I am.
Wow.
Do you ever ask your parents what the key to the success of them staying together that long is?
You know what? I've never really had to quite ask because I saw
You've
it.
You've seen it for yourself. So what did you see?
So what are the keys? Give us some keys.
First of all, I never saw my parents argue ever.
But they did, but they just didn't let
they
you
probably
see it?
They probably did. But it was just one time, it was close, and I know they would laugh at the story now, but my dad, like I said, he was always helping people, and one lady called the house a little too late,
and
my mom was like, Sam, it's too late.
Mm-hmm.
He was like, yeah, but she,
that's too late.
Yeah.
And she should have known better.
And I know that he's had the authority in the house, but I saw how he respected her reaction.
That's right.
Me and my sister were about 6 or 7, maybe.
Wow.
So we looked at each other. We felt like.
And you remember like, that? Isn't that amazing? At 6 or 7, you remember that?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, but yeah, and a lot of women, not a lot, some women don't know protocol when it comes to married people. Don't call, and it goes both ways.
Yeah.
Don't call somebody's house, especially if they're married after a certain time, and you're calling for the opposite. Sex.
Well, I'm not married, but I have a question since both of y'all are. How late is too late when you're married?
Who's married? I'm not married.
Oh, you're not? Married?
You're single? I was married for 9 years. I've been divorced for 3 years.
Wow. Oh, I thought you were married.
That's so transparent on this show, but
we're very transparent.
Oh, yeah, we are.
We just keep it real.
Yeah, I feel like y'all 110.
Check it out. We should have warned you. Praise the Lord.
Oh, we should have warned
Transparency
you.
Is the we're best pretty. Testimony,
you did.
Though.
You told me.
I did.
Yep.
Just keep it real. I mean, and be real with yourself too. That's the thing.
Yes.
Self-evaluation is the key.
Yeah.
But to answer your question,
I still want to know.
I was about to say to answer your question.
I'm taking notes.
To answer your question, really, after business hours, if it was business,
that's 5 o'clock, ladies.
Or you know, 6, 7. But if you're calling after 9 and 10 and 11 o'clock at night,
like that commercial where that guy is on the phone talking to the insurance and the lady comes down, he's like, who are you talking to?
Yeah, right.
I would be like, but the thing that I trip on is she says it's a guy, it's Jake. I'm like, ew, that's even worse. I would have been like, Jake from State Farm, what the heck?
Right.
And you know, baby? Some people need to recognize too, it's a dual street, because my dad, he learned after a while with wisdom how to shut it down after certain, you know, because you need to give people that access and they don't understand, you know, because he had full respect for his wife, but at the same time he left that door open.
Mm-hmm.
You know
mm-hmm.
what I'm saying? So it's just like after a while it was like nobody call after a certain time because it's your family time, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? So
live and learn. But that's good for you to have seen. And now you were married for 9 years.
Mm-hmm.
That seems like a good successful length of time. I mean, it's not obviously forever in your case, but 9 years, some people can't even make it 2 or 3.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you at least get through 9 years? What did you guys?
Oh, wow.
Can we dig?
Well,
you know what? I let me just say this because you look a little uncomfortable. We're going to get, we just want to give people insight
to
who you are.
Answer, yeah,
I know who you are. And because everything as has brought you to this point.
Okay,
you know,
I hear you.
The successes and the failures. Yeah. And one of the things that we definitely want, because, you know, we put our stuff out there, is that God, you know, a lot of people think, and I used to think this way too, if I had a big failure with something I did in the past, that, you know, it meant that God couldn't bless me. My purpose gets thwarted because I made a mistake. You know what
I'm
mean?
I'm a failure.
Like, I can't, because I lost my virginity, because, you know, I won't be able to find, you know, God's best for me. You know
right,
what I mean?
Right, right,
so,
right.
You know, so I just wanted to let you know that it's okay.
Yeah. I was just, the bewilderment was, how do I articulate this in such a short,
yeah,
I don't even know how much time we have, but let me try to put it in 2 minutes.
Okay.
For one, I mean,
that beautiful blessing right there.
Do the math. Yeah,
just
so
gorgeous.
Yes. But what we only knew each other 4 months when we did get married, and there was some immigration issues that we had to sort through. So I could really say it was God and what I learned through my, what I saw through my family, that kind of lasted that long. This is a hard work, you know, you got to put the work in, and, you know, this is, even to this day, this is her first time hearing all of this, because she's still like,
right,
oh, you two can get married. Like, that's the way I.
Oh, well, let's not talk about that. No,
it's
more.
Okay. It's cool.
Because you know what? I have to remember the baby is here, right?
Yeah. Oh, she's
I know.
Yeah, she's looking at me like,
no,
she's
her, that look right there is, he said he was going to take me to the mall to a fancy restaurant after this. And so, how long are we going to be here, Daddy?
Oh,
that's what
see.
That look is.
Sweetie, it's going to go by so fast. You're not even going to believe. We'll
and,
take
and
pictures.
And you're going to have an opportunity to tell us about your treasure that you gave me, okay?
Yeah.
Yay!
So
moving so
we're
on,
not, we're not
we're going to
Daddy
talk
long.
About
your
music and what brings you here. and really, you know, how was it that God led you to music, especially growing up, you know, seeing your dad being this learned man? Like, that seems like a artsy way. He probably was like, oh, no, you're not, son, you're not, you know.
Hey, you know what? I wanted to go to...
You sound just like him. That's pretty good. No, I'm just kidding.
We were talking about some of my friends that I went to college with, and they were all in the music program, like Jonathan Nelson and them.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I was in the math program. So, yeah, I did go through that exact thing.
I know your dad was like, no.
He, I tried to go to the arts high school, and my dad said, this is how I used to talk, son, I highly recommend that... you seek options that give you more options down the road.
Sure.
Seek those options now. So I said, but Dad, I'm really good at it. You know, he was like, I think, you know, you should reconsider. So what happened was, I ended up going down to the art school, I auditioned, and they said, we just don't see enough innate talent in you to pursue. Maybe you want to pursue some other things.
Wow, wait. Told you. Now, y'all heard the list of people that this man has worked with, and here he was told early, seeds just planted early on to try to steer you off course. They said innate, meaning basically you don't have any talent to do this.
Right, going to ninth grade. They
but they
like,
told Luther the same thing. Luther Vandross did, that he wasn't marketable. They told Anita Baker that she sounded like she had marbles in her mouth or something, whatever they said. They basically, she couldn't sing. Mary was even told by someone out there back when they were first starting that they weren't as talented, and all these people become super successful.
Yeah, exactly.
So whatever.
But go ahead.
Yeah, and it came from church. That's where I got the encouragement and the mentorship from people. You know, my dad played a little bass, so I would watch him. And then one day there was the choir director said, look, you have the ability to be greater than any of these musicians you see here if you learn a little discipline. Wow. And I was like, wow, these guys are great. You know, I was like 8 years old, like, look, they're playing the whole service and I'm barely picking a tune. But it was someone who took the time to mentor and look me in my eyes and say, you know, you can do it. And they took a little time to show me and then take me to the music store, little things like that.
Don't kick the table.
Yeah, baby, because we can hear it.
Yeah, we can hear it.
And so everybody out there watching can
so
hear
don't
it
kick
too.
The table.
And it sounds like
I spend so much time with her that you notice when you were talking to me after, and 3 minutes in, she was like, Daddy, she's not used to that, which is kind of good and better than it is bad. But I'm teaching her now, like, okay, you are very the most important thing to Daddy sometimes daddy has things to do, so you have to wait.
Right.
So that's where she's five now, so I'm teaching her that part.
She can sit on your lap. Come on, you want to come down here with daddy and sit on his lap?
She wants her own mic.
Oh,
she wants
okay.
her like,
yeah, like okay, I
you have your yet. Own mic. Okay. She's like, hold up.
All right.
She might be five, but she wants her own.
Yeah.
Ain't that right? Give me some.
No, I saw you give her that daddy look.
Yeah.
She was like, oh.
But that's why I'm heavy on mentorship. Now, I mean, all this, I forgot about more people than I remember that I worked with. And it's such a blessing. Mm. Most of those jobs I got is because I mentored somebody and then they came up through the ranks and they were like, oh man, who can I trust to do this caliber of job? Then they end up calling me back.
Wow.
Or it's someone to where I got in a situation that they saw something in my heart or something that I did. They were like, this guy is different.
Yes.
So we're going to take, we want to try some other things.
I know you got a thought. I don't want you to lose it. Mentorship. That means you sow time for free at nobody's expense but your own.
Mm-hmm.
Please hear me when I say this.
Right.
So often people want something for nothing. And I know this should be encouraging you because you're the queen of mentorship. Your whole house is a mentorship. So I really want you to be encouraged because it's like when you pour out and you pour out and you pour out, it just seems like, when is the return going to happen? Mm. When God says it's going to happen, but it's going to happen because his word's not going to return void. So that's a standout point you're very successful. So,
and it's not, sometimes it's not, I mean, it's a struggle sometimes, you know, but we get up in the morning and we're just so, I know you're the same way, so grateful for another day.
Yeah.
Yes.
And look what God gave me.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I'm saying? So before my feet even hit the ground, I've already said, God, I thank you for this day.
Mm-hmm.
I've asked the Holy Spirit, what am I supposed to do today?
Mm-hmm.
I already said my affirmations that, God, I'm going to do something great for you today.
Yeah.
I don't even know what today is going to be, but I know I'm going to do something great for you today.
Yeah.
And then I just don't want to get out of bed bitter or angry about anything. And that's when the blessings start happening.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sowing seeds in the kingdom, that's where those big returns come from.
And there are people out there that look at us having that mindset, because I do, and they're like, I've been called corny.
Mm-hmm.
Or like, yeah, right, she really believes, or she really means that, yeah, right. And that's because they miss our hearts.
You've been smiling the whole time. I mean, we just...
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll be corny for that.
But you know what? I just call you called. That's what I call you.
Yeah.
Because last night, you know, I work part time in with the adolescent group home.
Mm-hmm.
And do I have to work there for the little money they pay me? No, but I just took a cue from God saying, you need to be here for this season.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when I was talking to three of the girls, and the kids that are there, they're adolescent young, they're young people in their teens, and they're there for drug abuse, eating disorders, and cutting, and issues like that, depression, anxiety, and these are kids that maybe come from not broken homes, but, you know, homes where they have two parents, or they have, you know, the luxury of finance situation, but they find themselves in a dark place. And so, you know, the group home takes them to church, and I asked the girls, I said, so are you guys excited about going to church tomorrow? And one girl was like, well, I'm an atheist. And the other girl said, I don't have any faith. And then it was like, that was my moment. Like, when you look for those moments, it's not always in the big or directly in your purpose or what you're doing, but that was my God moment for what I was supposed to do that day. And I was just like, so glad I was open to God to be sensitive to see that moment, because I could have just went in, set up, and be like, y'all go to bed. And I said two words to these girls, and So I like what you said. Yeah,
good.
I like what you did. Please. I went overtime and sent them a little bit late. But
good. You need to have Bible studies up
and
in that
not,
house.
I'm not like I'm going to say I'm a prophet, but I just call it like I see it, because I know how it goes. When you do those types of things, you know, there's different laws in the kingdom than in the earthly realm. It's like you going in the earth, you plant a seed here, and you know what's going to come up, and you know how much of it. You know exactly where it's going to come up, but not so in the kingdom. You know, you plant your seeds over here,
and
then it comes from somewhere else. You have no idea, from someone, and just, you know, because if we knew, then we would be God that sense. And you know what I'm saying?
You know, and yes. I that thought occurred to me because, you know, Charles Stanley, he's this huge pastor mm-hmm. with a great big ministry, but he always talks about that one person in his life that impacted him mm-hmm. to be committed, his grandmother mm-hmm. and the seed she sowed and, mm-hmm. and the different influences that he had in his life. And so, you know, had they not taken that time out, then he, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And they're not here today to see the impact of their words and their time and their love and their direction. But, you know,
we won't always know.
You're going to see it in your career.
Yeah.
Though.
Yeah.
Well, we do receive that.
Yeah. Yeah. You receive that. Yeah. Receive definitely. That.
Because, yeah. No, yeah. I tell her all the time.
It could be a resource or like some type of anything, you mm-hmm. know. That could just build your career, but mm-hmm. God has said, you know what? She went and just helped the kids.
That's right.
She's been sowing seeds doing my work. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. No good thing would he withhold from those mm-hmm. who walk uprightly. Mm-hmm. It's a million scriptures.
Yeah, I know. Isn't that crazy? It's like you it's so much in your head and you go.
He'll blank. Give you the desires of your heart. You
yes,
know
he
what I
will.
Mean?
Yeah. Do the things that are pleasing in his sight. Keep his commandments.
You know what?
Matthew 6:33.
You know what?
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these other things will be added unto you.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Come on, brother now. Come on now. Come up in there.
But you know, it's condition based. You got to be obedient. You can't be straddling the fence. You can't be a fence straddling with the Lord. He don't play.
Then you have your reward.
You have your Yeah, and then don't, you know, if you know, he's like, don't even be lukewarm with it because he hates that too. So
and
you
let me say this,
100.
Let me say something.
As Latifah would say.
You mentioned planting seeds. A lot of times people really want to see the manifestation of the seeds they planted, but what they don't understand is sometimes it's our job just to plant it, mm-hmm. it's someone else's job to water it.
Yes, yes.
Someone else's job to prune or God's job to prune or someone else's job to help that plant continue to grow, but it will grow. But imagine if you just plant the seeds like you did with the babies. I mean, who knows how long you're going to continue to work there, but they'll always remember you starting things off and God will always remember that.
Right,
so,
right.
You know, and you were talking about discipline and these people talking to you about being disciplined as you were telling me about your journal. Way back when we first started talking, mm-hmm. I was thinking to myself, wow, what discipline does it take to start a journal at a young age and continue to write in that journal all the way up until you're almost 40 years old?
Mm-hmm. You're amazing. A guy. I don't think that's a guy thing.
That's amazing.
Unless you're John Boy from my date myself. Nickelodeon.
But that's Nickelodeon. Discipline. You know what I mean?
That was, I started that journal. My dad, I seen him work from... Oh man, I'm from Baltimore, okay? Mm-hmm. I've seen every side of Baltimore. We grew up, right. probably, we craved, seen my dad work us from the worst possible conditions up until now. Like, now him and my mom live across the street from the Baltimore Ravens. Like,
wow.
They're out there. The governor lives on their street and all that.
Wow.
But, they tested me to get into a school because my dad, he always helped me with my homework and stuff. He tested me to get into one of the best private schools out there. They couldn't afford it, but my test scores helped. And whatever he said to them, I ended up in this school and they taught that discipline.
Mm-hmm.
They said, this is like only the Jewish elitist kids were given this privilege of going to the school.
Yeah.
And they were taught always right. And then we would look at the different disciplines, like the Quaker discipline,
wow.
to read the Torah, stuff like that. I would
so
look at their culture.
A lot of cultures.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe that's the cue that the public education can pull from the private education book.
Right.
So is it safe to say you're a Christian?
Yes.
Okay. So when people, do they ever ask you, why did you choose Christianity, even though you're aware of all of these other religions? And,
yes.
and you studied them. They're not just having awareness, but right. you've like read their books.
Yeah. Culturally, I came up in the church, but there was some moments where I had to be introspective and say, okay, how do I answer this question? You get to a point sometimes and you ask, why am I here? And it's not taught like this in the Christian religion. But that was basically Abraham's question. I mean, he is the father of faith, But if you look in the Jewish culture and the Hebrew, actual Hebrew language, he was asking God, why am I here? Because there was no God to man before. It was God, God's relationship to Adam, and he spoke yada, yada, yada. But it wasn't a relationship with his people and a formalized spiritual connection. So Abraham was like, why am I here? And basically, when I came to ask that question, through all the religions and spiritual disciplines that I looked at, my relationship with Jesus Christ was just, to me, that brought everything together for me. That is the underlining thread and common thread of every spiritual experience. That's mm-hmm. my connection to God, for one. Mm-hmm. So with that, you know.
How do you describe the Holy Spirit? How do you describe your experience with the Holy Spirit?
The Holy Spirit to me is, how do I articulate this? He is the voice of God, the real-time voice of God, and the presence of God with me right now, every day.
Mm-hmm. That's
and
great.
Yeah, that's what mm-hmm. That's what the Holy Spirit is to me.
Sometimes it's the chills and the warmth.
And
it's
sometimes
weird.
It's like you walk outside and the Holy Spirit is say, slam on your brakes for a second. Put your brakes on. And somebody comes zooming through a red light.
Yes, yes.
Or, you know, your child is about to say something, ask you a question you're not prepared for, mm-hmm. the Holy Spirit will calm you for a second and say, just say thank you. Just thank God right now. Yeah. And then you're ready for it. You know what I'm saying? Just little things.
Yes.
Okay. And big things.
Well, with that being said, we got to take a break. Thank you so much. We're getting such wonderful nuggets of insight into who you are as a man of God, as a talented man of God, as a gifted man of God, as a father. And when we come back, we're going to get some more 411 on you and your experience with working with folks in the music industry, mm-hmm. Both on the faith and the secular side. This is Roe Williams.
Hey, I'm Trisha Mann Grant, and we have Jay Deal in the house.
We'll be right back with more gospelrhythms.com, Talk Live Radio on latalklive.com. And actually, when we come back, we're going to come back to your latest artist that you're working with, Brent Jones, one of his songs.
Okay.
So you'll be sure to check that out when we come back.
Don't go anywhere, y'all.
Yeah. Don't get a friend.
Hi, this is Kenny Lattimore, and you're tuned into GospelRhythms.com, Heaven's Party here on Earth.
Hi, this is Elena inviting you to join me every Wednesday at noon for Elena's Beauty Talk and more, exclusively on LA Talk Live. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Angela DeJoseph. Join me Thursday evenings at 6 p.m. Pacific, The Angela DeJoseph Show. We're going to talk about health, wealth. We're going to share news, interviews, and entertainment. So don't forget to tune in to The Angela DeJoseph Show, Thursday evenings at 6 p.m. Pacific Time. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, Radio Flag, TiVo Radio, and now live on Facebook. Watch and listen directly on latalklive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Barbara Perkins inviting you to join us every Sunday afternoon at 2:40 for Sisters at the Well Radio, a conversation with women about women. Join us as we share stories about current events, jazz events, business opportunities, health and wellness, entertainment, and so much more. So don't forget to tune in Sundays at 2:40 exclusively on latalklive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, or watch and listen directly at latalklive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Oh my God, I'm so excited. Jesus the Lord, you better know it. I can dance, I can dance, I can dance with him all night. I can dance with him all night. I can dance with him all night. Oh, oh, oh,
I can dance with him all night. Oh, 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 I can dance with him all night.
I've been in church for a long time. People make the worship and so song. Drop out the box, I've been in the church.
To do it all night, dance with Jesus.
You see me lip singing?
I'm not. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Wow. Welcome back, GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio. And that was I Can Dance remix produced by none other than our very talented guest, JD. And that was Brent Jones. Does he have the TP mob with him anymore? Are they?
It's a different, yeah, it's a different group on this one, but some of those guys are around.
Wow. Yeah.
That was hot. So what's your inspiration when you're in the studio and you're producing these tunes? What happens?
I look at purpose. What's the purpose for something? And then that's pretty much what lead me to what is the inspiration. I'm working on some, not right now, Takada. I'm working on film and TV music, and then it's kind of tricky there because I don't know where the content is going to be placed all the time, but I pretty much get a direction, and then I get inspired by what it could be or what could be the maximum. I always keep the, this for anything, I keep the best possible outcome in my mind for anything that I do.
Yes.
Even if stuff starts to diminish, I say, what's the best possible outcome? Mm-hmm. And that's my inspiration. Go for that.
Well, I know we talked about how your dad didn't really approve, and we kind of fast forward it. But I just want to know, like, when he finally realized, when the aha moment happened, when you were afforded the opportunity to be in the business, that he said, nah, I don't think so. So, what was that moment like?
It goes up and down. I mean, it has been up and down recently, because there was a time when oh, that's over there. It's like, there was a time, there was one time when I was on tour with a group, and we were in Paris, and one of the female fans ended up fawning all over the talent, and her boyfriend was there, and he was a gang member, and he had a gun, and he was a part of the rival gang of the security they hired for the venue.
Oh, isn't that special?
So the security was like, this is not our problem. We're not going to try to stop this guy right now. The guy ran up on us with the gun, chased the van, shot out the window. Wow. The venue was a block away from the hotel. So they rushed us to the hotel. The guy's running behind us. He's right there.
And this is in Paris?
This is in
Paris.
They
got gangs everywhere.
That was my first or second time in Paris. I didn't even want to go back, but I've been back like 6 times since. But the point about that one time is he ended up about as close as you two are pointing a gun in my face.
What?
And so you can imagine the conversation I had with my dad.
Like, I wouldn't even have told him.
I didn't tell him for years. I ended up going back to school. And when I was back in college, then it was like, had that conversation. He was like, and then, son, but then you get more mature, and like you mentioned the Holy Spirit again. So I've worked with secular artists after that point. But I think the aha moment for my dad finally came. He started seeing me. Oh, God bless you, dear.
I'm hanging in there. Go eat.
I'll take you to get some soup after this.
But the aha moment.
Yeah, kind of when I started becoming a dad, and I started texting him little things like when she was 3 or 4 weeks old, I text my dad like, thank you for every diaper you changed. Thank
Doesn't
you.
Doesn't it make you appreciate your parents a whole lot more? You're like, wow, you went through
to
this?
The max, right.
Oh, and wait then till she gets
You mean diapers right. that he changed on you or her?
For me, change my diapers. Now it means something. When boy, I said, change your diaper. How you going?
Yeah. But let me tell you something. That appreciation is going to continue. I have a 12-year-old and a 19-year-old. The appreciation for your mom and dad will continue on and on throughout the years. As you see. Enjoy this innocence right now. Enjoy this sweet. Oh, I love my babies to pieces. But, I mean, you go through the changes as a parent because they go through the changes into going into adulthood.
My friends called it seasons. It's just a season that they're in. Seasons with
you. It's a season of hot sauce.
It's a season. But I brought you in this world. I took you out.
Yeah, you understand what that's like. What, Daddy?
Well, we didn't introduce her. What is that lady over there? Air time. And what is your name?
Yes.
Microphone.
Takara.
And you have another name.
Treasure.
And Takara, that means treasure, right? See, I learned it. I was paying attention. Now, you have something that you brought that you gifted me, and I wanted you to share exactly what that is and the story behind it.
You want to pick it up and show everybody?
Because you're on camera.
Right there on that camera. There you go.
What's that called?
It's a CD.
Oh, my gosh.
And what's it called? What's the title of it?
I got to take a picture of it.
Well, you know what? She doesn't know the official title. This is called Treasure Collection in Dreams.
I had to do that.
Wow.
And
I'm doing
this
it too,
music
girl.
Was inspired by her. Her godmother is a pianist, incredible pianist. And she was playing music, just thinking about her after she was born. And I said, I have to record this.
Yeah.
So I recorded about full 74 minutes of it's beautiful, romanticized type of classical slash. It will put you to sleep if you're tired, or you can play it behind conversation at a party or something like that.
And you have one for each of us, yes?
Yes, I do.
Actually, I sure do. Treasure probably, because she gives one to everyone that she meets.
So Mary Gaylord?
Mary Gaillard.
Gaillard.
And that she's actually Marvin Gaye's daughter-in-law.
Awesome.
Yeah, she's come
that
from
name
very
should
musical.
Be familiar, right?
Well,
y'all just
yeah,
did
my husband yeah, just played Marvin Gaye in Zeola Gaye's.
Wow.
And Zeola, his sister,
yeah, yeah.
She's awesome lady. Yep. Love her to pieces. Mm-hmm. She's one. Hey, Zeola, we love you in case you're watching.
So you just got musical, talented genes all up in the pool. No basketball players coming out that family, but you can best believe.
And we got some ball players,
you got some
too
ball
now.
Players.
You
okay.
play ball?
I used to.
Yeah.
I used to. I got on the court the other day and had to. Yeah, they got the worst of it.
Yeah.
Right, so yeah, you should have had me on the squad,
playing,
you know.
They were playing 50, you know, every man for himself. And,
right.
And some guy had 45, another guy had 50. And I say, can I play? They were like, take your chances. And I won.
Hey, you,
you
got
just
to show
got the,
what time
you got
it
the
was.
Golden touch. Well, yeah. Now tell us about this project. That, you know, I mean, has it been in the works long?
Brent Jones?
Yes.
Yeah, we've been working on it for a while. And, I actually produced two projects on him, and this was the first one to get out. He called me to do the one that's going to come out second is the one he called me for first,
mm-hmm.
which is totally you. If you turn it on and you don't know what the words are, you're going to think it's like a T-Pain album or a Chris Brown album.
Oh, wow.
The sound is very extremely progressive, but it's all the content is it's not controversial at all. It's mm-hmm. uplifting, encouraging, mm-hmm. word-based, and it's hot.
Nice.
But he had another project in the middle of me producing that one. He started playing for me. He said, yeah, this is something I worked on back on the East Coast, and it was more like small group praise team type. He's like, yeah, I'm going another direction now. I said, while you're going that direction, let me finish this going to its destination.
Right.
Because this is hot. And we finished that album, and now we're going to finish the first one's almost done anyway, so.
Okay, good deal. Yeah.
So awesome. That one's going to be released before this one? Is that how you
the
do it?
The one that we just heard will be released first.
Oh, okay, mm-hmm. gotcha.
Yeah.
So if someone wanted to use your skills in their film or their television show, how can they reach you?
Interesting.
You have an agent?
I thought about it. My agent is God, basically, so. And I used to work with my... with her mom. She was very good, you know. She's from Tokyo, so
yeah.
Japanese people have a different perspective on business,
mm-hmm.
and now I adopt that myself. Mm-hmm. But depending on the scope of the project, they might find me different ways. I mean, I'm very easy to find. Mm-hmm. I'm at my church almost every day,
which is
Faithful Central Bible mm-hmm. Church,
which is where
on 333 West Florence Avenue, Englewood,
know.
California 90301.
But if you're not in California, how would they get a hold of you?
I have a Twitter account, I have Facebook, I have most of the social LinkedIn. I don't check them frequently.
I know, same here.
But if you want to catch me for real and it's and I'm supposed to have it, and you can find me.
Yeah.
Okay. I can
Wikipedia
be found.
Him. That's what I did.
So, yeah. Okay, so you do have Facebook. You don't check it often.
I deactivate it maybe 60-70% of the time.
He's in and out.
And then,
so
yeah, and then I come on and give updates.
If you need
and,
him, you'll get him.
Yeah.
Well, no email. Okay, so we'll talk about that.
Well, thank you for
coming in.
I am looking for an agent. How
but
about
you know,
that?
But I may want
to. But it has to be a spirit filled, spirit led agent.
That's all right, you know.
And I don't work all the other thing is I like to mentor and teach and do other things. And some of the challenges before is that I would have an agent or a manager that knows how much money I could make if I just did everything that people sent to me. And like, how are you going to turn T-Pain down? I don't like the content.
Okay.
Or I might like it, but it's not for me to do it. Somebody else can do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm cool with doing movies and TV now. They know how to find me. But hey, I think you might know some people too that need to find me.
I'm trying to get your information. Well, you know what? You know how to find them.
Right.
If it's meant to him. That's how you want it.
We'll talk after the show.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. But I admire that because it's like, you know, all money is not necessarily good money, you know?
This is true.
And that says a lot when you say you could be clocking all that dollars, but there's a bar of integrity that you won't cross just to get money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Amen. And that's something to remember. Just because God bless you with talent don't mean you have to exploit it, because it's Jehovah Jireh, not Job Jireh. Remember that. That
was for free. Can I say something to our viewers? It's just on my heart. Thank you, guys. Just thank you. Thanks for watching us. Thanks for hanging out with us. Thanks for passing the word. We just thank you. We appreciate you guys.
And can I say something?
Hope we see you next Sunday, too.
I just want to thank Ness.
And we want to thank Ness.
And Richard.
Feneric.
And the whole LA Talk Live family. This is a gorgeous space, a gorgeous studio. We've been riding shotgun with them for over a year and a half, and it has been a wonderful ride. And I mean, if God couldn't have picked a better stallion for us to ride into the radio sunset on, then LA Talk Live, baby.
Yes, baby. And thank you, J Deal, and the beautiful Treasure / Takara. How do I say your name, sweetie? Takara. I just wanted to hear you say it, girl.
Takara.
You go.
Takara.
and Ro. Thank you. Thank you, Ro.
And Trisha, thank you, girl.
Thank you, girl.
Especially when I be blowing my nose. She be giving me looks sideways like, girl, did you just not do that? Okay, I'm learning radio etiquette. I'm sorry.
Really? Blowing your nose? I mean,
check this out. This isn't sexy either, though.
Well,
okay, I'm back.
That's a little better, though. All right, you guys, we're going to let you go now. We thank you
we'll
so much.
You next
God bless
week
you.
For our entertainment edition.
Have a great week and stay prayed up.
Bye.
Hi, this is Sonia Everett McKee, the author of Why Are You Single? And you're tuned into GospelRhythm.com, Heaven's Party here on Earth.
Hey, everybody, it's Amber Bullock, and you are listening to GospelRhythms.com, Heaven's Party here on Earth.
Yo, it's your boy Trailer.
And the mind, the swag.
Representing Free LA. Like us on Facebook. Twitter, Epic Free LA. We up in here kicking it with angels.
And glowing things. Very glowing. Very, very.
Who said you can't have fun in Christ? We on the job on this black man that you call us Steve.
Yo. Free LA's the movement. We bringing that newness. Here to bring a change, better notify the clueless. A new shift that brings order to the outer line. We come around and all the haters get terrified. Terrified.
Here the beat is a residence. It's your boy Church here to introduce our regiment. The king took our sins. Now we looking innocent but guilty of assault. If the lyrics are the evidence in the present tense, bringing change out the pocket. You don't need to check. I do direct deposit. And I ain't talking paper when I say I got a profit.
Every hater said I never make it to the top.
They say the sky's the limit. Well, see, mine is infinite. And if you're looking at the lyrics, homie, there's no gimmicks. Nah. See, homie, I ain't quitting until my job is finished. Or better yet, until I see the people in repentance. Ah, I'm not a puppet, y'all still toys. No lie, all truth, I'm real boy. No kill joy, sinners in the bag. No longer a filthy rag, the Lord is my laundromat. Evidence. You can put it past me cause I'm speaking in the present tense. Future kings and queens overruling every president. Seated, double defeated, we sprint while we rapping. Give for the father while even about to be victory laughing. Yeah, I was gone off the throne, but now I am back again. A broken church, but Jesus came and he repackaged it. Took my heavy heart and my lonely nights and he salvaged it. Then called me his bride and showed me what a true marriage is. Praise to my heavenly father who washed away my sins. Gave me a new life, a new heart and all his righteousness. No, I don't pack a pistol. But I got epistles. You might dodge a bullet,
but it's where I won't miss you.
Go ahead and subscribe. It's about all the issues. Don't worry about the world. Nah. The world won't worry with you. They just wish to have it, but all we have is tears. Yeah. Don't be a silly rabbit. You know,
chicks off a kid.
You will make the greatness a divine gift.
Word. If you walk the list, then it's a paradigm shift.
Swag, swag.
You can't make frames
be making, breaking, taking moves, strategists that never lose. Drumming the finding the time in the line in the sofa. In clouds of doom, boom, making the evening. Be like when we breathe in, faith we receive in. Giving while we heaving. Opposites of heathens, without reasons, we will please them. Undaunted by the bounded foe, 2012 the seasons, one of four. Hitting fours among our peers, without fear. If I'm lost by your standards, then I'm safe by his mantle. Step your man of those you haters. See you now, see you later. Pray for you, ask myself because I learned from my savior. May not be as strong as he was, but I cry every day. I may fail. Then I pray, and he take my sins away. Hey, we up with Jesus, the epitome of true seekers. We free up our souls because we are believers. Believers had no second thoughts. We were unsound, underground, in the darkness we were lost. Now found by the cross like a path, anointed by the bath of blood that was spilled on all of our behalf. Once I was half, now I run it over till we run to heaven's gates. No, our run will not be over. Sober, up to you wanna compete with our rock complete. Magnifique, opposite of weak, flaunting rock for weak. Holy Spirit unique. Pottery, please. Welcome to party, departed seas. Heart avoiding all disease. Faith walker. Listen to the gifts as we paradigm shift through the fog and the lines like this. Yeah. Listen to the rabble of a rapping holy mammal making a scramble to dismantle what the enemy has his plans for.
Are we done?
Yo.
Yeah.
Swag.
How do you stop this thing? Press the big red button. Oh. Here we are.
Me with no closure. Then 5 months later, you said you had another. What was I to do? I ain't over you. But when it feels like I'm happy, the pain keeps coming through. Yeah.
Hallelujah. Young people, there's nothing wrong with dancing for Jesus. But we can't forget where we come from. So if you don't mind, let's have a little church right now.
Something about that name.
Thank you, Jesus. Listen.
Something about the name Jesus.
Something about the name Jesus.
Something about the name Jesus.
Hallelujah. Yes,
yes,
sir.
It is the sweetest name.
Sweetest name I know. I love the name.
Come on and lift your hands and say it with me.
It is the sweetest name.
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus.
I know.
Listen to this right here.
Some people say I'm crazy, but I can't explain.
No, no.
The power that I feel, when I call your name.
When I call your name.
Said it's just like fire. Shut up in my bones.
Yes, it is.
And it just won't leave me alone. Oh, there's something. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Something about the name Jesus.
Yes, it is.
Something about the name Jesus.
Oh, I realize.
It is
a
no reason for you to look closer, but you do, so I show you. It ain't pretty here now, but it will be one day, I promise, when the sun rays are honest. I chip away at the tin on the windows, stain in the glass, it's a pain in the ass. I scrape and I scratch till my arms grow weary. Meanwhile, I warn you not to stand near me. I think I built the fence a little late. The demons were already in, now they can't escape. I've been toe-to-toe with most of them, though. As a whole, they must perish in order for me to grow. Huddled in the gloomy little cracks that they inhabit, they pass away the day I deactivate my habits. Each one gets buried in the backyard in tiny little graves marked only by a black scar. Kindly watch your step. The silence isn't finished being awkward yet. Trophies lay in the basement to stay safe. Today's mistakes are in a lighted trophy case, though. And I want you to know, only invited you cause I ain't thought you would show. But I'd be damned if you ain't grabbed my hand and presented yourself on the threshold of the heartland. Antique swords adorn the wall. They really not here for decoration at all. I save them from old relationships and I swing them at you later if you stay in the mix. Don't you realize nobody's really been inside here since it was last drenched in dry tears? Decorating was a senseless idea cause only the blind lonely prince resides here. We dine here on a balanced diet. Ego when it's loud, self-hatred when it's quiet. Inside the castle, this is what the life is. Sign here after you read the fine print. It's not much, but all of it's yours. Take great caution if you want to explore. Watch your head when you open in the doors. And always remember that the choice was yours. And I want you to know, only invited you cause I ain't thought you would show. But I'd be damned if you ain't grabbed my hand and presented yourself on the threshold of the heartland.
Tell me, how could I ever forget to be your lover?
And she starts bringing up older, and the fights keep getting worse.
All right.
Finding numbers in her purse, that I put that one left first.
Yeah.
And you know she ain't wearing her ring.
Oh no.
And she starts playing little games, come in and live from her.
If it wasn't for the makeup on my shirt, still out there chasing skirts, then
I couldn't remember.
And if it wasn't for that fight last night, you smashing out my head like this,
I couldn't remember.
If it wasn't for parole, steady ducking my P.O., girl, you know
I couldn't remember.
But silly me, babe, tell me how could I ever forget to be your number? Now I realize that you need love to spend my life making up. Oh, I forgot to be a lover.
When she starts bringing up old,
bringing up old shit,
and the fights keep getting worse.
I'm telling your brother, you better put your woman first.
She ain't wearing her ring.
Oh yeah.
And she starts playing little games.
I'm telling your brother,
you better put that woman first.
Like it wasn't really nothing.
So many ways.
Kept to myself, always running.
So many games.
All that ass me.
So many words.
I need you to stay.
Always came first.
Even though sometimes felt like second.
If I don't love.
You know I had to learn a lesson.
Spend some time.
Put in some work.
If for better or worse.
Always put that woman first.
Start bringing up.
It's one mic, one beat, one stage, one nigga front, my face on the front page. Only if I had one gun, one girl, and one crib, one God to show me how to do things, the sun dead pure, like a cup of virgin blood, mixed with 151, one sip will make a nigga flip, writing names on my hollow tips, plotting shit, mad violence, who I'm gonna body, this hood politics, acknowledge it, leave bodies chopped up in garbages, seeds watch us, grow up and try to follow us, police watch us, roll up and try knocking us, one knee I duck, could it be my time is up, but my luck, I got up, the cop shot again, bus stop glass burst, a fiend drops his Heineken, ricocheting between the spots that I'm hiding in, blacking out, I shoot back, fuck getting hit, this is my hood, I'm a rap to the death of it, to everybody come on, little niggas is grown, hood rats, don't abortion your wound, we need more warriors soon, shit from the stars, sun and the moon, and it's like a police chase, the street sweepers and coppers, stick up kids with no conscience, leaving victims from doctors, if you really think you're ready to die, when nines out, this is what nines is about, nigga, the time is now. All I need is one mic.
One mic.
That's all I need. All I need is one mic.
One mic.
All I need, niggas. All I need is one mic.
One mic.
Yeah. All I need is one blunt, one page, and one pen, one prayer. Tell God, forgive me for one sin. Matter of fact, maybe more than one. Look back at all the hatred against me. Fuck all of them. Jesus died at age 33. That's 33 shots between Glocks and 16 apiece. That's 32.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
in Manila. Gorilla and chinchilla, ain't nobody realer. Ice cold like Nilla, wicked like Jay Dilla. Superman strength, call me Bobby Bonilla. Vanilla and canilla, apple bottom filler. Poo nanny killer, chicks scared to kill him. I'm a hustler by nature, MC by fact. I ain't no buster, plus I can rap. Take out opposition, put them in submission. Detention for they pension, add an inquisition. Look in their eyes, you could tell if they lying. Look into my eyes, got the heart of a lion. Yeah. Homie, put a siren and get yourself running. Okay. Hip-hop, Royal Highness, hun second coming. Yes, I've been done, did it, and I'm running for the top spot. Spit grown man, raps the rest, just hopscotch.
I'm out of my head. I'm out of my head. I'm out of my head. I'm out of my head.
Out of my mind and into my zone. Okay. Sip on some wine and text on the phone. Okay. Rock the house party, watch the kid play. What? Bang, 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 like pops all day. Pay to stay away, cause you ain't touching nada. Hot chicks round the way, but devil wears Prada. Hope always go harder than the average. Rapper, what you saying, partner? Confused like Scrabble. Get it in your head like a neurosurgeon. I get these, watch how my bread be burning. Don't you understand? Is you hooked on Ebonics? I flow current like electronics. Jump on a track like House of Pain. Warm it up like crisscross, can't out the flame. Freak, freak the track super like my name, Rick James. Drop the guac on the whip, now I'm switching four lanes.
I'm out of my head. I'm out of my head. Play with the heat. This Cassidy and MJ on this Swiss beat.
We hustle.
12 months of the year.
We hustle.
It ain't a bunch of front in the hair.
Gotta yeah. hold my man down. We ain't playing around. Got his back at all times. That's the bottom line. We hustle. To the day we die. We hustle. To keep our love alive. To my fam in the streets. We bringing the heat. Cassidy and Mary J. on the Swiss beat. We hustle. 7 days a week. We hustle. Just to stay home.
Fair, respected. I want a thing hold for clan to wreck it. If you don't like this song right here, then your ear's infected. You need to get your hand corrected. Stones clan the necklace. I wear so much plaid on my neck, it put bruises on the back of my neck. That's why cats is upset. But I told you I'ma shine when it's time to. I put too much time and I've been rhyming since 9-2. I knew I'm a hustler was a hit, cause everything I ever got I had to hustle to get. Ain't nobody give me nothing for free, but I'd probably be dead or in jail if it wasn't for tea. Getting booked is a and catching a slug scary. I need to feed my seed, thanks for the love, Mary. But seeing me without the grams on the grind is like seeing Wesley Snipes in the Tanner's line. I'm the hustler, hustler. Do that dance. Yeah, let's go. Do that dance.
cross these show run down. Or run down hangs around PSU's campus. Or Yates or Wheatley High School. Try to hustle him a few nickels. Cause he hustles off the paper. Don't work for nobody.
Happiness in this, all I feel is bliss. simple stuff. I'm taking in the moment, taste the soul that's in the air. It's all I need and I'm already there. This is my getaway. This is my sweetest game. Soak in the sunshine. This is the good life. This is a better day. This is my holiday. I put your happiness in this. All I feel is bliss. This is my holiday. I find true happiness.